Okay, so those who have joined, you people kindly write your name in the chat box, okay? So good afternoon to you all. As you have seen the routine, so I will be taking this subject like software engineering, which is like an open elective, professional elective, I think, for you people. So what will be my way is the software engineering theory part I will take, and the software engineering practical classes Pulustu sir will take. So since this is mainly a theoretical subject, so I will try to tell all the things in the form of in the story, and in the meantime I will be writing in the whiteboard, and you people just listen to what I am saying, so that in the form of stories itself you people will get to know that what is the logic behind this. Otherwise, this software engineering entire syllabus, it's a bit theoretical word, theoretical. So if you just only focus on studying the definitions and all, you people will feel a bit bored. So in the form of the logic, you people just listen to what I am saying, and then it will be easier for you or a little bit interesting for you. Okay, so is this whiteboard visible to you all?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
So what happened is this commercial usage of computers, they have spanned our world like in the last 60 years, right? So earlier what happened is computers were very slow in the initial years, and also they lacked a lot of sophistication. Because in the earlier days, you people would have studied that long, long, big size punch cards were there, and big size machines were there, that one machine will cover up or fill up an entire room. So since then, a lot of computational power and sophistication has increased rapidly, and also their prices have dropped. That is, when earlier, 10 years ago, you people would have thought of buying a PC, it was very costly. But if you look now, almost any normal average salary income person, they can buy a, at least if not a laptop, they can at least buy a PC in the range of 20,000 to 30,000 with the different assembled parts. So our computational power has increased, our sophistication has increased, but prices have also dropped. So to get this type of idea on the kind of improvements that has occurred to these computers, if you think in the field of aircrafts, if you think in the field of bicycles, this type of sophistication has not arrived. It is not that airplanes was very big in the earlier times and it is very small now. No, bicycles also, it is not that the cost of one bicycle has increased very much. No. So if I put it in other words, this computing technology, this advancement in this computing technologies field is unparalleled with any other field of what we see worldwide, right? So the more powerful a computer is, the more sophisticated the programs it can run. So with this increase of like sophistication and computing capability, software engineers have been called upon to solve these increasingly large and complex problems, and that too in cost-effective and efficient ways. Now I can say that you people can, after each my writing of each thing, you people can just take screenshots and you people can write it down where you people are doing writing the notes and all. But it will be a theoretical subject, so a lot of writings will be there, okay? Wait for a minute. Let me just take the picture. Okay. So, if I am speaking about the emergence of the software engineering process or the software engineering subject, then I can say that the software engineering, it didn't start off as a single subject. Like the developers, the programmers, the team members, they gathered experiences from their past and they incorporated few knowledge, and together they emerged the different guidelines in order to design a software or design a hardware, like whatever it is. So these innovations and this past experience, when we collectively combine and in order to deliver a good product, then we say that from that point, software engineering as a discipline, it has emerged. So it was not that one fine morning the subject software engineering was invented. No. But it may be that one fine morning the C program was invented. But unlike that, software engineering as a discipline, it was not invented one fine morning. This is not an invention. It is like what the programming patterns that company or that development team has followed in the past, and what are the new things the development team are incorporating now. So after studying these things for each and every organization, they tend to develop a few guidelines in order to develop their software, be it a product, be it a software service, anything it is. So this forms the basis of software engineering principles. Now, when we say that what is this software engineering all about, so we can say that about the definition of software engineering. Okay, so if I say that what do you mean by software engineering, I can say that some good programming practices and some techniques, that how to write this program, after writing this code, how I will test my code, which section of the code I will test first, which section of the code I will test next. So all this systematic planning, all this systematic collection, this is referred to as software engineering. That is, it will discuss the systematic as well as the cost effective techniques for any software development. So software engineering discusses the systematic plan or the systematic technique and also the cost effective technique for any software development. Now, these techniques help to develop the software using an engineering approach, and together we refer to it as software engineering. Now, is this term clear? What is software engineering term all about? Yes or no? Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, one example that why this thing is needed on the first hand. I will give you a very everyday example. Suppose in your house you have some patchworks to do in your wall. So you will call a mistri, a laborer, and for patchwork you do not need any architecture passed out big engineer. A small laborer you can call and you can do the patchworks in your wall, in your room. Now, if you give that a project of making a new room or making a new floor to that laborer, he will stumble. And suppose in the need of money, he says, yes, I can make this thing. I will build that floor for you. So what he will do? He won't be able to plan in a good way. Why? Because earlier he has been never exposed to making of any floor. He was just a normal patch worker. After this project was given to him, he do not have any knowledge that how many laborers is needed. If I want to finish this work, this estimation process, that if I want to finish this work in 1 month, how many laborers will I need? How many laborers I will engage in the dhalai process? How many laborers I will engage in the cement making process? So this entire estimation thing, and also how much cement is required, how much thing will be required, how I will measure, all these things he doesn't know so well. So what he will do? He will start making. So this can happen that on the very first itself, it will crumble. And also it may see that maybe he has been able to develop something, but it didn't go for 4 to 5 years. Within 5 years only, that building collapsed. So this failure is very much certain. So when I will want to develop something, I will have definitely have a plan for the development. That is, at the first, I will first ask the customers, what are the requirements of you? That is, you have told me that you want to make a floor and there will be two rooms. What is the size of the room you are expecting? What is the exposure of the room expecting? Where are you? Do you want to keep the windows? Where do you want to keep the door? Do you want any attached bathroom or not? So first you will take the input from the customer who want to make the floor. Then you will sit and you will decide that how much cement is required, how much time is invested, how much labors will be invested. So all this planning need to be done. If and only if a proper planning approach, a proper engineering approach is applied to any software, then only you can build a software. Now you may ask that suppose I want to build an online examination process for my college. It is also a software service, but I do not need that much of documentation for that, right? So there is a term known as software engineering in large and software engineering in small. For smaller things, you may not need that much software engineering approach. It is true. But when we talk about organizations, companies, definitely we need a good software engineering approach where we will plan the entire thing, what we want to execute. Then only after planning only we will be able to start our execution. And also there will be checkpoints, there will be endpoints. That is, after every phase we will see that what I have expected, that in 1 month I will do this, whether that thing is delivered or not. In 2 months I will do this, whether that thing is delivered or not. This is the work of a manager. We say na that the manager manages the thing. What does he manage? Wo aake ye nahi dekhta 8 ghante employee kaam kar rahe ki nahi. No, he doesn't check that. His role job is like what it is planned according to the document which I have, that planning is going as it is or not. If any deviation is there, he needs to step in, he needs to improvise and all. So a software engineering approach is always needed in order if you want to develop anything, be it any product or be it any service, okay? So this is the evolution of how this software engineering process came, what was the need of the software engineering process. Without the software engineering process, what problems might a customer can face, or might the product or the service itself can face, due to which this subject was introduced. Next, we will study about a few terms. That is, first term which we will study is the software life cycle. अच्छा हम तो बस वन वे कम्युनिकेशन हो रहे हैं, हम तो बोले ही जा रहे हैं, तो यू पीपल आर गेटिंग राइट व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू से? दोज हु हैव जॉइंड लेट, यू पीपल काइंडली राइट योर नेम इन द चैट बॉक्स, बिकॉज फ्रॉम द चैट बॉक्स आई विल गिव द अटेंडेंस इन द एलएमएस पोर्टल. ओके ओके, सो द नेक्स्ट इज व्हाट इज दिस सॉफ्टवेयर लाइफ साइकिल. Now, by life cycle, it is well known that all living organisms, we undergo any life cycle. So, suppose when a seed is planted, it germinates and then it grows into a full tree and then it maybe it finally dies. So, if I am based on this concept of biological life cycle, then the term software life cycle, it will define what? It will imply the different stages or the different phases over which a software evolves. That is the different stages or phases over which a software evolves. And when I use the word evolve, what do I mean? That is, it will start from the initial customer request. That is, a customer will come to a company, na? Then it will say, I need a software, it will help me, where it will be a platform for all the teachers and the students to register themselves, like this, this, this. I have certain things. So when the customer goes to the company, he will have a request that what he wants. So starting from that inception to the time that the software is fully developed and handed over to the customer, and finally supposed to a stage that maybe that software is no longer used, that is updated, and some other version, improved version of the software has come. So all the different stages and the phases over which a software slowly grows, right from the inception time, from where the request came in order to build the software, till the software is fully developed and to the software has stopped existing or it is existing further. So this entire thing is known as software life cycle. Okay, so the life cycle of a software, it represents a series of the different stages through which it evolves during its entire lifetime. So if I put it, it represents Okay. Now, as we have already pointed out, that this life cycle of every software, it starts with a request for it by one or more customers, suppose. So at this stage, the customers, now they are not usually clear about what the features they need or it will be needed, or neither they can completely describe the different features in concrete terms. So when a customer comes to a company, so that person vaguely describes what is needed. Suppose he will say, I want a platform where I can input some teachers, then also some students can register according to the location. A teacher will be appointed to a student, they will talk with each other and then they will sort out and I will get a notification. So this is a very vague thing, that is to be very concrete. How many teachers you want, how many students you want, what is the maximum limit a teacher can take a student, what is the maximum limit that a student can take a demo class from teacher. So there are no concrete words. So when a customer comes with a expectation of making a software from a company, he vaguely says that what it describes. So this stage where this customer feels a need for the softwares and he just forms a rough ideas about the required features, this stage is known as inception stage. Okay. So this is where the software is starting to be just made. So this is the inception stage. And starting from with the inception stage, a software, it evolves through a series of identifiable stages or phases, and the development activities is carried out by the developers and until it is fully developed and then it is released to a customer. Now, can anyone say that once you buy a AC, what is the next thing you might need after 2 to 3 months? Or 6 months, suppose you buy an AC, the AC is working fine, it's giving you a lot of relief in the summer season, but just after 6 months of its working, what is that thing which you need? Anyone? Lina, bolo. Lina, bolo, what is that one thing you need after you buy a AC and it is working for suppose 6 months? What is that one thing you need? क्या करते हो 6 महीने जब चलता है AC उसके बाद एक बार किसको कॉल करते हो?
Maintenance, ma'am.
Right, very nice. Right. So once a product is developed and it is handed to the customer, na, the stage doesn't stop over there. Because once installed and made available for use, the users will start to use the software. And this will signal the start of the operation, that is maintenance phase. Right? So as the users will use the software, they will request for fixing any failures. Who they will request? They will request the person who has made the software. Then suppose they want some new modifications or they want some new improvements, they will definitely again come to the software. So this maintenance phase, it continuously makes changes to the software to accommodate the different change requests from the user, to accommodate the different error fixations. So this operation phase, to be very honest, this maintenance phase is usually the longest of all the phases. Because if you notice also, you people buy one thing. Suppose the production for that thing has taken 1 year. You people has bought it in a fraction of a few months. And you people will use the AC for suppose up to 6 years, 10 years. So it's very obvious that the maintenance phase is the longest of all the phases that is in the, that constitutes the life of a software. Okay. So with this basic knowledge of software life cycles, we will now discuss one by one the development life cycle model, why it is necessary and so on. Okay. So I will move on to the next topic. these things comes in the exam. Like maybe for your, this is the first time this subject is included because you people are under GOT, but in our BTEC and also in the under Kolhan also, this small sound deflections very comes, okay, comes very often. So what do we mean by SDLC model or the software development lifecycle model? This has a few other terms also. It is also known as software development process model or simply a development model. So these two terms, software lifecycle model or software development lifecycle model or software development process model, these three terms are used interchangeably, okay? But they all, these three terms, they refer to one thing only. So what is this entire SDLC all about? Now this SDLC, it will describe the different activities that need to be carried out in order for the software to evolve in its life cycle. But this representation is done graphically. Okay, so SDLC, what it does, it graphically, it's a picture basically. It graphically depicts the different phases through which a software evolves. Now, one thing, this SDLC, as I am saying, it will graphically represent the various stages of the life cycle. It will show the transitions among the different phases. And there may be small textual description of the various activities that need to be carried out that after, during a phase or before that phase can be considered complete. So textual description of different activities may be written, but it doesn't emphasize on how the process is done. Suppose if I am asked to show a graphical representation or something, you are making some program. So first you will do what? First there will be a briefing by the customer. Right? So after that briefing, maybe some initial coding is started. A very small thing I am telling, okay, simplest terms. So after that, maybe after the code is made, some test is done. Then after the test is done, maybe some modification is needed. So maybe some modification is needed, and after the modification, again the test needs to be done. So it may happen that when the test is done and some failure has occurred, then some modification is needed and again I send it to test. And it may happen that after the test, my software works perfectly, my software works okay, and I am saying that my development is complete. Right? So this is a graphical representation with some textual description in some boxes accompanied with it. So suppose this is a small, suppose this is an example of a small program making, okay? So this will be the SDLC model of my program, of my software. So I have...
Ma'am, please repeat it.
Kahan se repeat kare, bolo?
मैम ये जो साइकिल आप बताई ना सॉफ्टवेयर डेवलपमेंट लाइफ साइकिल, तो इसका प्रोसेस क्या है वो समझ में नहीं आया.
अच्छा, सपोज तुम्हें तुम एक स्टूडेंट हो और हम एक टीचर है. आई हैव टोल्ड यू दैट यू प्लीज मेक अ सॉफ्टवेयर वेयर every teacher will take the attendance and the students will log in and they give the attendance. This is a very simple thing which I have demanded. So I have briefed you something about the code. So this is one phase. Then after briefing, you have understood the, okay, my teacher wants me to build this, this thing. So I will make this thing. So you started your coding part. And suppose 2 to 3 months of coding, you have like you think you have developed the code, then you will do what? You will ask me that test this section of my code, madam. You give your inputs and test whether this attendance is working for you okay or not. So you will test. Two things can be there. For few inputs, it is working okay, and for few inputs, it is not working okay. So that is a failure has occurred. So when a failure has occurred, I as a customer is not satisfied, I will tell you that you modify your code, please, okay? Problem is happening. This is not what I have expected. So you send your code for modification, you modify your code. After modify, you again test it. You again say, madam, I have modified again. Once again, you please test it. Then also another failure I encountered, again you modify. And suppose after innumerable modifications, one day, I am seeing that, okay, the software which you gave me, everything is working okay. So I am saying that, okay, your development is complete. Your software is okay for me. I will now buy this software for you. So this is an entire graphical representation or a pictorial representation that what are the phases or what are the development stages my software went through in order to build the app which my teacher has wanted. So this model or this is an example of an SDLC model. This is the way how we use or we model our development phases. Is this clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. The next topic is Okay. Now, the next thing to tell you is that why this model is necessary. Now, you tell me, suppose this is a small thing which your teacher has demanded from you. You are alone enough to make that code, to modify that code, and to supply that code. Okay, now suppose you have a big company, you work in a big company and the level of projects they take, they are like 1,000 projects they take and like 10,000 employees, 20,000 employees they have in one city, they have the same branch in other cities, so a lot of employees are working on the projects. So if they do not follow a particular plan, they do not follow anything, so what will happen? One developer will start developing one part of the project, another developer will start developing another part of the project. Maybe one has followed his or her own abbreviations, another one has followed his or her own abbreviations, so it will create a lot of chaos. So what usually happens is every software organization, they have their own set of guidelines. They have their own set of rules. That is rules for declaring variables. I'm not saying that these rules are something different from the C rules you have learned. No. Variable declaration rules only they will follow, but they will have their own standards. So this will be standardized across an organization, across the entire region. For what? So that any team, when they will recruit, they will able to follow the guidelines. And since all of the persons, they will follow one guideline of the organization, they can work in coordination and the output will be a very good quality software. And also the chances of time overrun and cost overrun, this will always be minimized. So suppose if you take an example of a routine, I give you a routine and all the classes, suppose it is going as per routines. So obviously it is synchronized across the department between us and between you. And suppose if I take one class instead of Wednesday, I take one class on Saturday. Instead of Saturday, I take one class on Tuesday. I am taking the class. My job is okay. But I am not following the guidelines which is decided by my department. So what will happen? It will create a chaos. So and if someone is checking my recordings, then also it will create a chaos, because in the routine it is saying I am taking a class on Monday, and when I am searching by the date of 4th May, I am not finding anything. So for this reason, this software development lifecycle model, one model is very much necessary for all the developers, team members to follow, so that the completion of a team-based development project, the successful completion of a project takes place. Okay. Now, this was all about today's class. I will stop here today, because I think if I am going on lecturing for a long period, you people will definitely feel a bit bored. So up to now, whatever I have discussed, is there anything you people have not understood or want to ask? Okay. So what I will do is, in the LMS section, there will be a section for lecture materials where I will be uploading the notes. And there will be a section for video lecture materials where I will be uploading the recordings, so that if you want to refer to any recording in the future, you may. Okay. So let us stop today's class over here. Since no one is asking any question, I think you people have understood. So thank you so much for attending today's class. We will meet in the next day. Okay.